From personalised purses to cheeky cheese, Mr. Cupid Carrington is here with his gifts for next week's Valentine's Day. And John Wentz making me chicken and leek pie, but there's a twist. And it'll be served in a mug. But there is a reason why I've now got gloves on, because of the next segment we're doing. When you think of British wildlife, you probably think of foxes, badgers, birds, that kind of thing. You wouldn't necessarily think snakes, lizards and turtles, but my next two guests are trying to change that. Conservationists, or rewilders, they like to call themselves, 17-year-olds Tom and Harvey are building the country's largest outdoor breeding facility for reptiles and amphibians to stop them going from extinct, and they join me now. Nice to see you both. Thank you for coming in. So Harvey, just kick us off on what this is all about for you guys then.
So I mean, you know, it's about halting extinction, and what we've learned from time and time again is if you ever want to stop a species from going extinct, you breed it in captivity. And you don't just breed one or two, you breed literally thousands of them. And that's exactly what we aim to do, because many of these species, some which we brought here today, are animals which many people don't actually know how to breed as well as we'd like. So it's basically what we call conservation ex situ. It's just about breeding the animal.
Yeah, and Tom, you want to create an outdoor facility for them, don't you? And yeah, give us your ambitious plans, because it sounds amazing.
Yeah, so it's going to be the largest facility in the UK for these species. And there's going to be more reptiles and amphibians than Chester Zoo. So wow. It's quite a big operation. They're all kept outdoors, and that's something that we pride ourselves on, that we love to do, is keep these animals outdoors in as much of a natural setting as we possibly can. They're in greenhouses or outdoor enclosures, and they've just got the natural sunlight, which you can't replicate indoors.
Yeah, and you're two mates who just came up with this idea, aren't you? I love it. So, for anyone watching at home thinking, oh, what, so you can actually see some of this wildlife at home, what would you do in your garden,
I think the best thing to do is add water. I mean, number one would be to build a pond, and that can be from the size of, you know, a swimming pool all the way down to the size of a kitchen tub. And wildlife just comes straight to, you know, any sort of pond.
That doesn't include a hot tub, John.
I do love a hot tub, but I actually built a pond on my patio last year out of just an old cattle trough. And the amount of stuff you see in there, and the beautiful, like, look at Eurasian jays coming and having a bath in there. No newts or tadpoles yet, but I'm sure one day soon we'll have that strike looking.
And what are the tips then? So water, anything else you can do?
I'd let the lawn grow. I mean, let wildflowers into your garden. I mean, the plants are the basis to any food ecosystem. Mm. And so what we need to do is draw in the insects, and then everything else will follow. And I'd say hibernation sites, specifically for reptiles and amphibians, are so important. And that's as simple as dig a hole, chuck a load of rocks, logs, whatever, leaf litter, and just make a mess. And you know, amphibians and reptiles will use that in the winter.
Can you do that with those like bug hotels as well? You can
build
like
exactly.
Ideal.
It's just creating living space. That's all it's about.
Yeah.
And leading on from that, one of the biggest problems any wildlife is facing globally, really, is the destruction of their habitat. And in order to combat that, we need to connect up habitat. And the worst thing you can do in your garden is build like a palisade fence, because it immediately stops animals from moving. So the best thing to do is cut a hole in your fence, or get rid of the fence entirely and put a hedge in, and that can provide so much space for nature.
Yeah, and you've brought some of that nature with you. So Tom, do you want to tell me, is something you'd find here in this country, isn't it?
Yeah, so what you have there is Britain's rarest lizard, which is the sand lizard.
Wow.
If you just pick it up from the belly.
Yeah, from the belly.
They're very tame, so I doubt they'd start to wriggle off.
There we are.
So these are really the pinnacle of captive breeding success in the UK. They were once in populations as sparse as 1,000 in the UK, and they've been brought back to all over the south of the UK and lots of different areas. And it just proves that captive breeding does work when you're trying to save species from extinction.
Yeah, it's got a hell of a tongue on it, hasn't it? Brilliant. So this is the sand lizard. It's interesting, isn't it? Because I thought it would have just automatically jumped off me, but it seems to be quite tame. What's John got then?
So you may be surprised to hear that there are lizards in the UK, but even more surprising is pond turtles. Now, they did go extinct a few thousand years ago, but those there, you can pick one up, just
basically from the shell.
Yeah, just.
And is it okay to pick them up? We're not hurting anything,
are we? Yeah, yeah. It's like me and the bath on a Friday night thrashing around. Oh my gosh, that is gorgeous.
And they're so beautiful. They look like they've been dusted with gold. And the thing about them is, we probably wipe them out because early humans used to like the taste of turtle.
You're actually shaking.
It's quite wriggly. It's like
Can we have a look at one of the bigger ones, John?
I'm not touching that big thing.
That is thrashing. Can I pick the big one?
Yeah, yeah, just grab either sides of them, yeah.
Do they bite?
No.
So if I don't give it any leverage,
it may scratch it. He's going to pretend to swim in the air, but...
Oh, that's like what little puppies do, is it?
Oh. Wow, the skin's incredible,
but look
isn't
at that. It does look like I've put that gold glitter spray on it, doesn't it?
It's
kind of lustered. And he'll put it back because he's a bit timid.
And that's a species we want to see back in Britain once again. And as climate change warms, you know, the country, that is a species which will increase its range across the UK.
So could we have these in our ponds at home then?
Potentially, yeah. I mean, it's not ideal to introduce them yourselves because of the threat from disease and things. But if we want to really rewild ourselves and rewild the places which we live, then who knows, the future, you know, we're going to have wilder spaces.
This is amazing.
Would they have lived in, like, just ponds, or would they have lived in, like,
wetlands
and brooks and things?
Lots of different habitats. So wherever there's water, you'd find that.
And beavers, too. I mean, beavers create incredible wetlands that all of these species love to thrive in. Mm. And we're increasingly learning that beavers are a keystone species, and if we want, you know, a good wild future, we need to bring beavers back to the landscape.
Yeah, and Alan also has some snakes. So Tom, you tell us, how are you with snakes, Alan?
Good day, Sheila. I'm fine, thank you. I have a fierce python here. You want me to pick it out?
Yeah,
I didn't know they did them so small.
So what is this, Tom?
So that is Europe's longest snake, and it's...
Europe's longest snake?
That's a baby one.
It's a baby one.
If so I get around by the time I get it out,
escalating snake.
It's all
so any trick to picking it out? So tell us about this then.
So these are actually an arboreal species, so you'll see them in trees quite often. And they're Europe's only arboreal species in the north. And that they, you know, they used to be in the UK about 100,000 years ago, maybe even longer than that.
I imagine they have predators.
Yeah. Yeah,
so birds.
Birds will take them.
Yeah. So, how do you feel holding a snake?
I've worked with a few in my time. It's fine. It's fine. Better than I thought. Mind you, if it was much bigger, then it might be a different story.
Well, funny you should say that, because I think we're about to meet its parents, John and I. So, Harvey, tell us, what have we got here?
So these are the actual parents of those baby Escalapian snakes. And these just show you sort of the size that they can get to. And if you take the lid off there and just basically gently grab sort of the first quarter and the last quarter of the body.
What if it's all curled up like that?
Yeah, no, it's okay.
Are you all right?
Yeah, no. you go first and then I'll follow suit.
If you just scoop her up.
Is it this one a girl?
Yeah.
Right. Well, how do I pick her up, sorry?
Just gently scoop up. And just pick.
I don't think I'd be afraid of this.
She won't bite. It's the same one you held earlier.
I've got there sweat on here. I'm sure it's she has.
I thought that was just from the Yorkshire puddings.
Hello. Oh. Hi, I'm really friendly.
Has she got a name?
My name's Steph.
No.
But you're the snake.
Oh, that feels really weird.
Oh, can I pick that?
Because it's a shock horror slithery.
So that's the mum, and have I got the dad here?
Yeah, the dad is the darker one of the two in there.
Whoa. How did it happen? Oh my god, that's massive, John.
It's been quite big as well. You're talking about my Yorkshire puddings again. Have these ever killed a human being?
Never.
As far as we know.
Snakes in general, the vast majority of snake species are completely harmless. And in fact, these actually provide a pretty decent ecological service whereby they eat things like rats and mice, which eat grain and human food.
It's
not letting go of me. I'm being eaten by a boa constrictor.
Oh, it's all right.
If you just brush the tail off.
But they're so strong, aren't they?
The reason why is because they climb trees to basically eat birds and their eggs. So that's why, you know, their tail is so good at wrapping.
Oh, that tongue's very tickly.
Were you afraid of these when you first started to handle them?
No.
I mean, it's one of those things when you're this big, you just love nature.
It's okay.
That'll end up in a burger.
I did put that down gently, by the way, if anyone's watching it. Honestly, it turned on me that then. There was a glimmer in its eye.
How did you get into it, you two, doing this?
I mean, it's been quite a recent sort of interest last 3 years. But, I mean, Harvey's been... Well, you can tell you himself.
He got you into it then?
Yeah, he got me into it.
I've been really inspired by what's happening nationally, whereby large areas of the countryside are now being rewilded, so allowed to be returned back to nature. And it's a great opportunity to bring these extinct species back because we are restoring habitat at a pace which is absolutely brilliant.
Yeah. I think a few people might panic though if they suddenly see these.
that's what it's all about though, isn't it, with wildlife.
I mean, you wouldn't ever see a snake like that in the wild, I don't think.
They're so secretive.
And then the colour of the bark, so you wouldn't notice they're in a tree or anything.
I was in the Lake District once at a friend's house, and I saw it was like a little white, yellowish, tiny snake. It
would have been a slow worm. It would have been a legless lizard.
Sorry, Snake, you'd have a few drinks.
It was just a bit of a
roll. Amazing. Oh, well, thank you so much, and good luck with your project. Come back and tell us how it's going, because that sounds brilliant, doesn't it? The largest outdoor breeding centre for reptiles and amphibians. Fantastic. Put your hands together. Hey, well, there we are.